prolonged jaundice, the definition of prolonged jaundice. So persistence of jaundice in a term newborn, if it is more than 14 days, we would call it prolonged jaundice. And in contrast to that, in a preterm neonate, we would call it prolonged jaundice if the jaundice is persistent more than 21 days. So term baby, 14 days, preterm baby, 21 days. So again, prolonged jaundice, it's mainly unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. But there are selected occasions we would see conjugated or direct hyperbilirubinemia. And we will look at the cutoff and the definition of conjugated or direct hyperbilirubinemia in the next slide. So what does it mean by cholestasis? The word cholestasis means something related to bile. And we all know bile is being produced by the liver. And cholestasis indicates lack of production or lack of flow of bile. And it could be due to multiple reasons. Numerous reactions and transportation mechanisms do occur in hepatocytes and canalicular level. So the cholestasis could be due to multiple reasons, starting from hepatocytes, canaliculi, or maybe intrahepatic bile duct, or finally maybe extrahepatic bile duct. What's the cardinal feature of cholestasis? I'll be showing more and more pictures of poo or stools during this presentation because it's very, very important to identify pale stools. And I cannot talk about cholestasis without mentioning a picture of stools which are pale. So the cardinal feature for cholestasis is pale stool. I hope now you could see I have moved in my slides. Is that right? I've moved to the next slide. Could you see that? Just to make
sure. Yes.
Yes. Okay, thank you. So just like I mentioned, you can see in this image, the hepatocyte levels, so many reactions would occur, so many transportation mechanisms would occur. The production of bile would take place in the hepatocytes with the use of cholesterol and numerous molecules and chemicals. Then finally, the bile is supposed to come to bile canaliculi. And then it would flow through intrahepatic bile ducts and the bile will be stored in the gallbladder. And when the time comes, it will come down to the second part of the intestine. This is what which would happen if the things are occurring normally, but it is not the case in everybody, especially in newborns and infants with cholestasis. So basically the main message from this slide is the mechanisms and causation of cholestasis would occur at molecular level, cellular level, canalicular level, or at large duct level. Look at conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. We all talk a lot about conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. However, sometimes it's a bit confusing because some people do express the level in values, some people do express the level in percentage. So every day people question, what's the cutoff? How would we label this is conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, this is not conjugated hyperbilirubinemia? Again, various types of definitions do occur, and we'll look at this a little bit comprehensive definition first, then I'll give you a much simpler definition. So here, this reference has defined conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, or the same thing, the direct hyperbilirubinemia is a direct bilirubin level above 17 micromoles per liter at a total bilirubin of less than 85.5. Or the direct fraction is more than 20% at a total bilirubin of more than 85.5. However, the NICE guidelines have described it in a much simpler way, which I would really like, and the people find it easier to remember. If you could remember, the direct hyperbilirubinemia or conjugated hyperbilirubinemia is the value more than 25 micromoles per liter, that is enough. At any given level of total bilirubin, if you have a conjugated or direct bilirubin level of more than 25 micromoles per liter, that is significant. That can be labeled as direct hyperbilirubinemia. The problem with using percentage is, it's true the former definition has clearly set a cutoff, 85.5. However, if you just forget the 85.5, if you have a child who has got total bilirubin of 50, And direct bilirubin of 25, the percentage would be just 50%. So sometimes it's misleading. And it is difficult to communicate over the phone when you refer a patient, when you discuss a patient. So I would suggest you to go by the NICE definition. The direct bilirubin level of more than 25 micromoles per liter is direct hyperbilirubinemia. Let's look at the evaluation now. A baby would come with what which is going to happen in clinical practice. So you have a baby who have got prolonged jaundice, and if it is a term baby, we would say more than 2 weeks. The first thing you would ask is the color of stools, and you might ask color of urine as well. And if you have a baby with prolonged jaundice, you need to do split bilirubin. That means you need to have fractions of bilirubin or the direct bilirubin value. So you would request total bilirubin as well as conjugated bilirubin. So in clinical practice, sometimes we have seen the only total bilirubin is being requested in this kind of occasions, but please do remember to request split bilirubin in case of a prolonged jaundice. So now you know the simple definition of conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. You have a baby who have got a conjugated bilirubin of more than 25. Mostly if you get the split bilirubin, mostly the causes would be unconjugated, but you may be left with certain children or certain babies who have got conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. It's true you have asked the stool color, urine color before, but now if you have confirmed conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, you could directly observe the stool color, because sometimes it will be very misleading because parents might say it's pigmented, it might not be pigmented. So it's very important, the direct observation of the stools by the medical professional. Obviously, if you have got conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, you need to do other liver function tests. What do I mean by other liver function tests? So actually the liver function means the clotting and albumin, but in real, the day-to-day practice, we would call them liver function test in general. So I would like to have transaminases, gamma GT, alkaline phosphatase, albumin, total protein, PT, APTT, and maybe a full blood count along with that, which would help us to narrow down our differential diagnosis. So just to summarize, you have a baby with prolonged jaundice, you have got split bilirubin, and you have conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. So you have got rest of the liver functions, and you have looked for the stool color. Again, a little bit a step forward, if you have conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, the likely etiologies may be many. You might have a list of 100 or 150. So you are not going to go through all the possible etiologies at first instance. So let's identify what are the priorities. You need to ask two questions from you with regard to a baby who has got conjugated hyperbilirubinemia in order to identify the priorities. The two questions are, has the baby got pale stools? Is there any evidence of liver failure? So pale stools, it's pretty obvious. You will observe the stool color, and it may be various degree of yellow. It may be just partially pigmented or totally acolic stools. At the same time, you need to understand, am I dealing with a neonatal acute liver failure, though the child may appear well at the beginning? So the definition of neonatal acute liver failure for you to understand this slide is INR more than 2 or prothrombin time more than 20, not correctable with vitamin K. We really do not talk about hepatic encephalopathy in small babies because it will be very difficult to identify. So we go by the clotting mainly. So if you have a baby with neonatal acute liver failure, these are the mainly likely etiologies. So the management would be different, which will be beyond the scope of this talk today because it's a different topic. The management, investigations, and all the rest, the evaluation and everything would be something different to the talk today. So let's think, our baby has got pale stools. However, the baby does not have neonatal acute liver failure. So our priority would be excluding biliary atresia. There may be other diseases which could give rise to similar appearance of stools. However, the priority remains to exclude biliary atresia as other diseases could wait. So here on, I'm going to discuss about biliary atresia. So let's have a look at the general facts about biliary atresia. It is the commonest disease requiring liver transplant in childhood. Jaundice, conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, pale stools. I would say biliary atresia unless proven otherwise. The reason to emphasize this much is because still we see in day-to-day practice a lot of cases which were mislabeled as certain other etiologies, which has caused undue delay in diagnosing biliary atresia, thereby postponing the Kasai as well as the necessary other steps in management. By definition, it's a rare disease. However, it's not that rare in clinical practice. The incidence is said to be the prevalence is said to be in 1 in 5,000 in East Asia, and male to female ratio is 1 to 1. When we say biliary atresia, and sometimes people do say extrahepatic biliary atresia, sometimes the term itself would say it's kind of a simple extrahepatic biliary obstruction, just like gallstones. However, it is not the case. It's a very complex disease with heterogeneous phenotype. It is not a simple extrahepatic biliary obstruction. It is a progressive obliterative fibrosing cholangiopathy, which would cause progressive bile stasis, which would result in liver damage. And damage to the hepatocytes would be replaced by fibrous tissue, finally, which would cause cirrhosis and end-stage liver disease. It was a fatal disease many decades ago. However, with the discovery of Kasai portoenterostomy and the curative treatment of liver transplantation, now the children live a near normal life. What would cause biliary atresia? Unfortunately, though I would say it's the commonest indication for liver transplantation in childhood and one of the commonest diseases we would see in clinical practice in regards to liver disease, the etiology is not really understood. The occurrence could be prenatal or postnatal. This is very well supported by the small babies may have pale stools since beginning if the occurrence was prenatal, or they may have pigmented stools soon after birth and subsequently develop pale stools if the occurrence is postnatal. There are so many genetic factors and genes which were postulated in the theory of etiopathogenesis of biliary atresia. However, they are not very much proven. Environmental factors do play a role, and perinatal cytomegalovirus infection. We all know cytomegalovirus is well known to cause neonatal hepatitis kind of a picture, where it will cause cholestasis, and it has a link with biliary atresia as well. Perinatal CMV infection will increase the incidence of biliary atresia compared to the general population who would not have perinatal exposure to CMV infection. And it would indicate severe disease course as well. There were theories which were postulated about ciliopathy as well, because biliary atresia is sometimes associated with situs inversus and lateral eddy syndrome. So people were thinking, is there a defect in cilia? Maybe there is alloimmune response. In the literature, it is documented that increased maternal CD8 has an effect, like a graft versus host disease kind of a picture in utero. There was an interesting finding in Australia, which was observed in lamb, where they were found to have biliary atresia on their autopsies. And retrospectively, it was found they were exposed to a toxin called biliesterone. However, this is not really demonstrated in human. Hereby, I would like to introduce this term to you, syndromic biliary atresia. There are two main types of biliary atresia, syndromic biliary atresia or isolated biliary atresia. So let's look at what is this syndromic biliary atresia. When biliary atresia is associated with other distinct congenital abnormalities, it is called syndromic biliary atresia. And this type of biliary atresia is known to occur earlier in embryogenesis. And the disease course is relatively severe. And these are the characteristic malformations which occur with syndromic biliary atresia. They would invariably have splenic malformations. The commonest splenic malformation is polysplenia. And at the same time, they could have situs inversus, preduodenal portal vein, absent inferior vena cava, intestinal malrotation, cardiac abnormalities, and pancreatic anomaly. So if you see a cardiac an abnormality in a child who has got cholestasis, do not think only about Alagille syndrome. Think about biliary atresia as well. And it could be syndromic type biliary atresia. Let's now look at the clinical features of biliary atresia. I would like to classify that as early presentations and delayed presentations. The baby would have jaundice, pale stools, with or without dark urine, and hepatomegaly is quite an early feature. In delayed presentations, baby will be diplegic, abdominal distension will be there, and splenomegaly will be apparent. And I would like to highlight the fact, do not wait for the splenomegaly to occur. If you think about biliary atresia, that would be late. If you suspect biliary atresia, absence of splenomegaly would not exclude biliary atresia. If you see splenomegaly, that is worrying. If you see ascites, that is worrying. And in later stages, baby could have pruritus, irritability, failure to thrive, and coagulopathy may be due to vitamin K deficiency or maybe simply due to liver synthetic dysfunction. Apart from that, the baby might have features of syndromic biliary atresia, that which we discussed earlier. What would happen to the weight gain initially? Initially, they might demonstrate rapid weight gain due to hyperphagia. However, later on, there will be failure to thrive. I wanted to introduce these four types of biliary atresia because this will be helpful in our future slides and discussion. The classification-wise, some people classify it into four types or some people classify it into three types and then subtypes. It doesn't matter. Understanding the anatomy and certain key features would matter. So in the first one, you could see there is a gallbladder. And again in this one, I hope you could see my pointer, there is a gallbladder. Okay. So one of the key messages I wanted to give here was, you could have a biliary atresia in the presence of a gallbladder. There are types of biliary atresia which would have a gallbladder. However, the rest of the system would be atretic. And if you see this purple one, the one which I have encircled in purple, you could see a cystic kind of a structure. The clinical importance of that is, this is the type of cystic biliary atresia. So the importance is, this could be misdiagnosed as cholidocal cyst. So that is why understanding these types of biliary atresia would have practical implications. In day-to-day life, in your ultrasound scan, if you see gallbladder, if your radiologist comment gallbladder is seen, but you have persistent doubts about pale stools, this will indicate the ultrasound scan and the presence of gallbladder will not exclude biliary atresia. If the radiologist says there is a cystic structure, probably cholidocal cyst, but if you have a strong doubt this could be cystic biliary atresia, your doubts are not wasted. You need to have those doubts and you need to clarify that with a second opinion. I wanted to highlight few things about pale stools. In biliary atresia, the stool color may vary. You might have a different, you might have a range. Acolic stools, partially pigmented stools, or intermittently pale stools. Different types of clinical presentations would occur. And initially pigmented stools is a well-known finding in biliary atresia. And direct observation of the source is very, very important before you proceed with further evaluation. Sometimes the dark urine might stain the nappy and will give you a false reassurance that the stools are pigmented. How would the liver blood test help you in view of biliary atresia? You will invariably have conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. Will transaminases help you? It's true that we wanted to do the full liver functions to understand the current biochemistry, the liver status, degree of inflammation. But would it help to diagnose or to confirm biliary atresia? Not really, because AST, ALT, there is no specific pattern. It depends on the degree of associated inflammation caused by bile stasis. So the number wouldn't matter, whether it's 60, whether it's 200, it will not exclude or include biliary atresia. Gamma GT, I know we talk a lot about low gamma GT cholestasis, high gamma GT cholestasis. Yes, usually gamma GT is high in biliary atresia, and it's unlikely to be low, less than 40, it's very unlikely. However, the normal gamma GT does not exclude biliary atresia, and there is enough evidence to say there had been cases of biliary atresia with gamma GTs between 40 to 90 or 40 to 100. So if you have clinical doubts, your normal gamma GT would not exclude biliary atresia. And alkaline phosphatase again could be variable. Albumin, prothrombin time, it's good to have for you to understand the liver synthetic functions, the pre-existing liver damage. However, it would not directly help to diagnose biliary atresia. It depends on the timing of presentation and the level of vitamin K deficiency, which is associated. So in overall, getting all the liver functions, so the enzymes and the rest of the biochemistry would be helpful to understand the ongoing inflammation and pre-existing damage. And one key facts to highlight, the natural history of biliary atresia in early part of the disease, there will be transient improvement of bilirubin and transient improvement in liver transaminases, especially when you start them on ursodeoxycholic acid. So do not get reassured by transient improvement of bilirubin and transaminases. There had been cases of biliary atresia with a total bilirubin of 60 and direct bilirubin of 40. So it doesn't matter whether your bilirubin is very high or slightly high. If you have pale stools and meeting criteria for conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, you should take measures to exclude biliary atresia. What's the place for ultrasonography in diagnosis? It's a crucial investigation, I would say. You need to prepare the baby by keeping the baby starved for 4 hours. And you need to monitor the blood sugars during that time. Ultrasonography is subjective by its means. However, it's highly reliable in good hands. Experienced hands with necessary expertise, it's very, very reliable. The classical sign may be triangular cord sign or unseen gallbladder, ectretic gallbladder, collapsed gallbladder, or the radiologist might say contracted gallbladder. Importantly, as I mentioned earlier, they could have a normal sized gallbladder and still they could have biliary atresia. And cystic structure may be present in cystic type of biliary atresia, and the differential diagnosis would be cholecystocyte cyst. If you have persistent clinical doubts, if you are dealing with a baby who has got conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, pale stools, if the first ultrasound scan is reassuring, please proceed for expert opinion. And you might need more starvation and the scan to be done in experienced hands. Hepatic scintigraphy, HIDA scan, or in other words, TIBIDA scan. What's the place for hepatic scintigraphy in diagnosis of biliary atresia? It's indicated in doubtful situations in early presentations, I would say less than 4 weeks, the early presentations. Your child is more than 4 weeks, you haven't got much time to waste, because if it is biliary atresia, you need to immediately proceed with Kasai photoenterostomy, which is a time-dependent intervention. So you would not have time to waste by arranging a hepatic scintigraphy. it will need priming with ursodeoxycholic acid and phenobarbitolone to get the maximum effect. It's not specific for biliary atresia. You could have false positives like Alagille syndrome, cystic fibrosis, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. You might get a non-excretory scan. And importantly, non-excretory scan would not, non-excretory scan will be suggestive of biliary atresia, and excretory scan would exclude biliary atresia. Having said that, in conclusion, if you have got a baby who's more than 4 weeks, has got pale stools, please directly refer for cholangiography rather than taking time to arrange HIDA scan, because you might find, you may not find anything in the end. It may be inconclusive in the end. What's the place for liver biopsy? It is again limited use as a diagnostic test in biliary atresia. Liver biopsy is a fantastic indication for certain diseases and certain clinical scenarios in pediatric hepatology. And no other investigation can replace the liver biopsy and histology in those scenarios. However, with time, especially with the availability of the genetics, most of the liver biopsies and the clinical indications have been replaced by genetics and specific biochemical tests. So now let's look at about Kasai photoenterostomy, a fantastic surgical intervention which was discovered by Dr. Morio Kasai, a Japanese pediatric surgeon, in 1950s. As you know, biliary atresia is highly prevalent in Japan. And Dr. Kasai identified a child during the laparotomy who had atretic biliary system. So he tried this surgical method, which got evolutionized over time, and now we have Kasai photoenterostomy, which is as shown in the picture, where we will put a rule loop to the photohepatis and establish the biliary tree. Basically, what the surgeons would do is they will dissect the photohepatis and then remove all the atretic biliary tree, and they'll get a jejunal loop and then connect it to the photohepatis to enable the bile to flow to the intestine through that jejunal loop. And they'll connect the duodenum after a length like 45 centimeters from the portohepatis. There is a reason to keep this length. The reason is to prevent intestinal content going up to the portohepatis and increasing the risk of cholangitis. Assume if you have taken this directly to the portohepatis, the intestinal content will go into the liver parenchyma and there will be reflux and increased risk of cholangitis. However, having this part, having this length around 40 to 45 centimeter, would minimize the risk of reflux of the intestinal contents, which is coming like this, coming through this, to the portohepatis. We would expect the intestinal content to go down like this rather than having reflux to 40 to 45 centimeters to the portohepatis. So that's the reason to have this conduit, and finally it will be a proven loop. So pre-Kasai and post-Kasai management. How would you prepare a baby for Kasai and how would you manage a baby following Kasai? This is again critical. And before that, I would like to highlight a fact about timing for Kasai. What should we achieve? What should we aim? Is it 3 months, 2 months, or 1 month? I would say earlier the better, because the factors which would determine the success of Kasai are diverse and it's different from child to child. And certain children who had Kasai at 1 month will still have liver failure and die before 2 years, or certain children who had Kasai at 3 months would live 7 years, 8 years without a liver transplant. So you can't really predict. So earlier the better, and we would target for at least before 4 weeks, I would say. So it's not justifiable to wait 3 months if the baby has presented less than 4 weeks, thinking, okay, 2 months, 3 months would be adequate. So coming back to pre-Kasai preparation, it's good to prepare the bowel with lactulose, neomycin, metronidazole to minimize the bacteria going into the portohepatis and causing cholangitis. And ursodeoxycholic acid is beneficial to improve the bile flow. If you have found severe vitamin deficiencies pre-Kasai, you may administer intramuscular vitamins in the theater. Post-Kasai, again, the child's disease course would depend on the pre-existing liver damage. Babies who didn't have much pre-existing liver damage will cope up well with the post-operative period. However, the babies who had significant liver damage, they might develop ascites, edema, and severe infections post-operatively. There is a place for steroids post-Kasai. However, the place should be balanced with the risk of cholangitis. If you have a baby who has got severe episode of cholangitis, you may not give steroids. If you have a baby who does not have a severe episode of cholangitis but showing significant transaminitis, there is a place for steroids, which is a short course. Normally it's 2 weeks maximum high dose. Subsequently, you will tail off the steroids. And Japanese studies, they have proven so much benefit with steroids, and they actually use prolonged steroid courses. However, the Western world, they use steroids, short courses, not prolonged courses. It should be balanced with the risk of cholangitis, the biochemistry, overall clinical picture. Antibiotics will be administered 48 hours anyway. Afterwards, you will decide whether treatment dose should be continued or whether it could be converted to prophylactic dose depending on the clinical picture. You should closely monitor for signs of decompensation. And ursodeoxycholic acid and vitamin should be continued. What are the other aspects of management? Nutrition-wise, it's very important to look at the calorie requirement. And if necessary, if they are very much cholestatic, they will benefit from MCT feeds. And sometimes they will have loss of appetite and they will not feed themselves. So you might need to go ahead with inward nutritional rehabilitation and tube feeds. Nutrition is something a bit overlooked in neonatal or infantile cholestasis. Sometimes the medical professionals are struggling to find out a cause or to diagnose a rare disease. Sometimes we do miss the nutritional rehabilitation. And this is very, very important for the hepatic recovery because liver really, really like food. So the nutrition will facilitate the recovery. So nutritional rehabilitation will be considered as a medication to facilitate liver recovery. And fat-soluble vitamin doses are indicated here, and it's very important to correct fat-soluble vitamin deficiency because there had been cases where children sustained intracranial hemorrhage due to vitamin K deficiency, which is simply prevented by giving vitamin K. So it's important to look for that and to treat that. Ursodeoxycholic acid is beneficial in multiple ways to improve the bile flow. And in later stages, you need to manage pruritus if it is present. In small babies, it might present as irritability, so you have to be vigilant to identify pruritus. And obviously, counseling of the family. Because biliary atresia is a chronic disease. It's going to be chronic. It would end up having liver transplantation, again, something which would require long-term medication. So it's very important to keep the family in the picture since beginning and to support them throughout the process and highlight the importance of nutrition. One other important question is, what is meant by successful Kasai and what is meant by unsuccessful Kasai? This is again a common question. The facts to consider following a Kasai, these are the things which we would look at to understand whether this Kasai is successful or not. We would look at stool color, and we would like to have pigmented stools after Kasai. And clearance of jaundice is good. Improvement of bilirubin and rest of the liver functions, and baby will demonstrate good weight gain. Theoretical definition, the books would say 6 months. However, by 3 months, you would understand clinically which direction the baby is moving. And it's very important because rather than waiting 6 months, you need to plan liver transplantation for them if you feel this Kasai is unsuccessful. That is why this 3 months cutoff is important compared to 6 months book definition. Overall success rate is around 60%, even with timely Kasai portoenterostomy, as that is the nature of the disease. We shall look at factors which would determine the success of Kasai. Type and nature of biliary atresia. If the biliary tree was grossly ephritic, then we would expect a poor prognosis. Timing of Kasai portoenterostomy, earlier the better. Technical expertise of the surgical team. This is very important. In UK, many years back, Kasai portoenterostomy was performed in every hospital. However, they identified there is a significant difference of success rate among the centers. If that was performed in specialized centers where they would handle many number of cases per month or per year, the success rate was higher. That made United Kingdom to centralize their management in regards to biliary atresia. So at present, Kasai portoenterostomy is being performed only in 3 centers in United Kingdom, which are the pediatric liver transplant centers. And no Kasai is being performed elsewhere. And that has significantly improved the success rate of the Kasai portoenterostomy simply due to the technical expertise the team have developed. Pre-existing liver damage would adversely affect the success. And immediate post-op care, management of cholangitis, management of immediate complications, management of sepsis, judicious use of steroids, the duration of steroids, all these things would matter the disease course. Special characteristics like syndromic type biliary atresia, perinatal CMV exposure would have severe disease course, and many unknown factors, because in clinical setup we would see children who had Kasai very early in their life still going into liver failure 6 months, 7 months, and they did not have any of the risk factors. So there are many unknown factors with this disease which are yet to be understood, which would determine the clinical course. However, the intervention which is in our hands is mainly the Kasai portoenterostomy. That's why we would really, really encourage to go for Kasai quite early. So simply I would say successful Kasai, native liver survival is more than 2 years. So child would not require liver transplant less than 2 years if the Kasai was successful. Unsuccessful Kasai, native liver survival is less than 2 years, mostly it is less than 1 year. So if there is a child who has survived more than 2 years without a liver transplant, that is definitely a successful Kasai. The disease will progress. Child might require liver transplant at 3 years, 4 years, 7 years, or maybe at 20 years as an adult. So that is successful Kasai. If the Kasai was unsuccessful, child cannot live with the native liver more than 2 years. What would happen following Kasai? The journey has only begun, and there is a rainbow in the end, you could see. So we know the disease is progressive, and Kasai is only a bridge for liver transplantation. The clinical manifestations are variable in nature and timing. If you take 10 children with biliary atresia, you will see prominent hepatopulmonary syndrome in one, you will see deterioration of synthetic functions in the other, and maybe the other child might have hepatocellular carcinoma in early life or portal hypertension. So if you get one child, you will not get all the complications. The prominent feature may be portal hypertension in one child, where the other child has got life-threatening recurrent cholangitis. So do not expect all the complications in one child. It is quite heterogeneous. However, you have to look for all complications, and depending on the severity, you have to manage them. It's very important to manage their pruritus, which would significantly affect their quality of life and address their growth retardation and fat-soluble vitamin deficiency. Liver transplantation is the ultimate cure for biliary atresia. Let's look at the indications for liver transplant. Portal hypertension itself is not an indication. However, if it is uncontrollable with endoscopic and medical therapy, then it would become an indication for liver transplant. Hepatopulmonary syndrome by itself is an indication. Hepatic encephalopathy, yes. Deterioration of synthetic functions in view of trends of clotting and trends of albumin. If there is evidence of hepatocellular carcinoma, yes, you have to consider liver transplantation early before they develop disseminated disease. That's why all children with chronic liver disease should be evaluated with ultrasound scan and alpha fetoprotein every 6 months. Cholangitis, if it is life-threatening and recurrent, yes, liver transplantation is indicated. Medically refractory pruritus, severe growth retardation, severe fat-soluble vitamin deficiency or hepatic osteodystrophy. They develop recurrent fractures and bone disease. So you don't need to have all the indications. If there is a child whose synthetic functions are preserved, however, there is significant portal hypertension which cannot be managed medically or endoscopically, resulting in recurrent bleeding, then that itself is an indication for liver transplantation. And there may be a child whose synthetic functions are preserved, however, has developed hepatopulmonary syndrome. Again, liver transplantation is indicated. And we have to consider liver transplantation early in cases of unsuccessful Kasai and delayed presentations of biliary atresia, where we would not go ahead with the Kasai sometimes. It's very important to have shared care with the liver transplant center in view of optimizing management, and that optimization would delay the need for transplantation. And it's very crucial to identify the correct timing for transplantation. Child should not be too much unstable to go through transplantation, and at the same time you need to balance the timing. Preparation of the recipient, preparation of the donor, having MDT meetings, all these things would matter. Knowing the ultimate cure is liver transplantation, they should be having shared care with the liver transplant center since beginning. My talk about biliary atresia would be incomplete if I don't talk about early diagnosis of biliary atresia. So I would like to highlight the fact about inquiring about pale stools if you see a baby or infant with jaundice, and making an attempt to observe their stools and educating the parents in an opportunistic manner. Whenever you see them for normal visits or maybe for minor complaints, please do educate them. There is a chart or picture in their CHDR which would help them to compare the normal stools and abnormal stools. And the cases of biliary atresia, the children with biliary atresia we see in the hospital, when we retrospectively inquire from the parents, they have not even turned the page, so which is very worrying. So we really need to educate them. There is something in the CHDR which you have to look at, which you have to compare with your baby's stools, and to bring them if you have any concerns. Other countries also use the stool color chart. Especially Taiwan, they have achieved a lot by using a stool color chart. They have performed early surgeries, early Kasais after early detection by a stool color chart, and their success of the Kasai has actually doubled after introduction of this chart. And their native liver transplant, the native liver survival have improved 3 times, and the need for the transplantation has got delayed. Japan has again achieved many good outcomes by introducing a stool color chart. So we had introduced, and we really need to educate the parents to look at that. And recently, Dr. Patrick McKinnon, a well-renowned pediatric hepatologist who currently works in USA and previously worked in UK, has written a nice article in Archives highlighting the importance of early diagnosis of biliary atresia even in the West. The average age at Kasai in UK is 8 weeks, which is not acceptable. And they are also struggling to get that done early because their routine visit is at 2 months, which is not really good enough to detect pale stools. So they are thinking of introducing something to the newborn screening, at least to diagnose the prenatal onset biliary atresia by doing conjugated bilirubin level with the newborn screening. That will be cost effective for UK because they already have a system in place. Might not be good for us at this moment, where we really need to emphasize on the stool color chart for parents. And having a newborn screening will still not detect the postnatal onset ones. So having talked so much about biliary atresia, now let's move to other diseases causing neonatal and infantile cholestasis, which I will be running through. So the list is like this. So I'll try to do my best with the slides. So low gamma GT cholestasis. So gamma GT, though we call it low gamma GT, normal gamma GT, high gamma GT, if you look at many references, no confident cutoff given. Some people say it's 100, some people say even up to 200 is normal for a newborn, but there is no consistency among the references. So we have to understand, especially in diagnosing of biliary atresia, do not take that concept too much, high gamma GT, low gamma GT, which might be detrimental. Low gamma GT means if it is less than 40, it is definitely low gamma GT. Or it could be normal sometimes above 40 and up to 150, like it may be just normal in a newborn. What are the likely diseases? If you have a low gamma GT cholestasis, the list is not very long. Progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis, 1, 4, sorry, there should be a comma, 1, 2, and 4. And ARC syndrome, arthrogryposis renal cholestasis syndrome, a characteristic syndrome with multiple congenital anomalies where they would have low gamma GT. And bile acid synthetic disorders. Those are the three main diseases which you might consider if you have a clear-cut low gamma GT cholestasis. Let's look at progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis. It's again a rare disease, equal male to female distribution. The defect is in the bile acid transport mechanism. Autosomal recessive inheritance where the incidence is high, consanguineous marriages. It's a heterogeneous disease which has got so many modifier genes and the disease spectrum is quite diverse. Cholestasis in the mother during pregnancy may be a clue. So this is a comprehensive table. So the main highlights of four types of PFIC. The genetic defects are different and the defective proteins are different. So you could diagnose and confirm them genetically. Gamma GT is low or normal in 1, 2 and 4, where the gamma GT will be high in type 3. Type 1, 2 and 3 would present early in infancy. However, type 3 only 1/3 would present early infancy, where 2/3 would present in older childhood or in adulthood. And type 4, again, limited number of cases could present in early infancy. Histology, again, non-specific. You would see canalicular cholestasis, hepatocellular necrosis, giant cell transformation, not quite specific. Earlier, they used to do immunohistostaining. Now it is less popular with the availability of the genetics, which would confirm the diagnosis. So if you suspect PFIC, you don't really need a liver biopsy if you have the facility of doing genetics. And sometimes in diseases like ARC syndrome, arthrogryposis, renal and cholestasis syndrome, liver biopsy is detrimental as they have undiagnosed platelet function defects. So we have to consider liver biopsy in a selective manner. Progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis type 1 has got extra intestinal features as the defective protein is distributed in other organs other than the liver. So it is there in intestine which would cause diarrhea, pancreatitis and deafness, and it might cause short stature. And some of the features would be more apparent following liver transplantation. All four types, the liver transplantation is indicated. However, in PFIC type 1, you might get complications like graft fibrosis and worsening of extrahepatic manifestations. Nevertheless, it's not a contraindication for liver transplantation. And supportive therapy with ursodeoxycholic acid, antipruritics, and all other medications to manage bile flow would be helpful in the conservative management. Alagille syndrome is again an important cause of neonatal and infantile cholestasis. It's a rare disease inherited as autosomal dominant. Known mutations are JAG1 and NOTCH2, so you could confirm it genetically. They will have characteristic faces. And it's a multi-system disorder. You get distinct abnormalities in eyes, vertebrae, in the heart, and in the vessels, and maybe in kidneys. They are highly cholestatic. The pruritus is very, very prominent. They will get profound fat-soluble vitamin deficiency. Usually synthetic functions are maintained till the end. high lipids, xanthoma, xanthelasma is very characteristic. They may develop hepatocellular carcinoma. Family screening is important as it is an autosomal dominant disease. Curative therapy for the liver is liver transplantation. However, there are other extra-intestinal manifestations which might cause trouble. Still, it is not a contraindication for liver transplantation, and there are children who do very well after liver transplantation for Alagille syndrome. So it is an indication. Infections, traditionally we know torch infection and other organisms like viruses, bacteria could cause cholestasis. This is again a comprehensive table with all the clinical features. One important message I would like to give is, again, the liver biopsy is not specific. Serology may be more specific than that, because you will get the generalized inflammation, not anything specific. Other than in syphilis, you might see treponemes in hepatic tissue. The treatment is disease-specific treatment. Endocrine causes are important to be considered if you have a baby with neonatal cholestasis. If there is hypothyroidism, adrenal insufficiency, or hypopituitarism, the commonest way is having unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. However, they could have conjugated hyperbilirubinemia and cholestasis. So if you have undiagnosed cholestasis, consider doing endocrine evaluation as well. And especially it is important to look at adrenal insufficiency before you discharge the child for follow-up, because we need to make sure you have not missed adrenal insufficiency. Surgical causes, we have discussed biliary atresia, colitocal cyst, straightforward by ultrasound scan. If you have doubts, you may consider doing MRCP, and the treatment will be surgical excision. The reason we need to do the surgical excision is they may develop cholangitis. Usually they present with an episode of cholangitis or sometimes intermittent pale stools. And in later life, they will develop cholangiocarcinoma. So it need to come out. Biliary sludge or inspissated bile syndrome could occur in the context of significant hemolysis. Medical treatment would be with ursodeoxycholic acid. And if it is not settling with medical treatment, you may need to go ahead with surgical irrigation. Spontaneous perforation of the common bile duct may occur antenatally or postnatally. Usually this is an unwell baby. Due to the perforation, the baby will develop biliary peritonitis, as the biliary content would leak into the abdomen. Baby will have ascites, jaundice, fever, abdominal tenderness. This is usually in the context of a sick baby with other medical problems. The diagnosis is made with high serum bilirubin in acidic fluid. Management would be supportive with IV antibiotics and drain insertion, and if it is not settling with conservative management, surgical repair may be needed. There are hematological or immune-mediated causes which may cause cholestasis, like gestational alloimmune liver disease, hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, or cholestasis associated with transient abnormal myelophysis in trisomy 21. This is just a word about alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. It's true, we don't see them much among Asians or in this part of the world. But when you go for foreign training, you will see a lot of children with alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. So I thought it would be good to mention a word. If you suspect alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, especially they may come with conjugated hyperbilirubinemia and pale stools. So in UK, before we send them to the theater for cholangiography, one investigation, if surgeon wants, that would be alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. So they would definitely ask alpha-1 antitrypsin level and the phenotype before taking the, at least the level before taking the child to the theater. That is due to the high prevalence in Caucasians. So the level is usually less than 0.6 in deficiency. These are the phenotypes. PIMM is normal and Z phenotype is abnormal. And you may get MEZ, which is a carrier state, and they will not have liver disease. SCZ would have liver disease. However, it's less severe compared to the full-blown disease, which is PIZZ. The characteristic features, they will develop progressive fibrosis and will have significant portal hypertension. and ultimately it is cured with liver transplantation. However, it's only the liver cure, they may have lung manifestations towards the later life. Genetic counseling is important, and you could do the specific genetic mutational analysis. I would like to briefly mention about Niemann-Pick type C, citrulline deficiency, and peroxisomal disorders. So these are the characteristic features. And all these three disorders are considered contraindications for liver transplant. So sometimes if you have undiagnosed liver disease and you will consider liver transplantation, so at least we need to exclude these disorders before you consider them for liver transplantation, because these would be contraindications. One of the main reasons would be due to their nature of multisystemic involvement. If you take Niemann-Pick type C, it will have neurological involvement. So that neurological involvement is going to be progressive. So these three disorders are considered contraindications for liver transplant. Bile acid synthetic disorders include MRTD cholestasis. The presentation would be neonatal cholestasis, A. coli stools, and they will have neurological manifestations due to cholesterol metabolites. The diagnosis should be made with analysis of serum and urine bile acid metabolites. Depending on the problem in the pathway, they would have characteristic metabolites. And the treatment is with cholic acid and quinodeoxycholic acid and sometimes ursodeoxycholic acid. So just a word about neonatal acute liver failure. You must have been wondering about galactosemia, tyrosinemia, whether we did miss those. Those diseases would mainly present as neonatal acute liver failure. However, they could come without liver failure as well. So I have listed a few causes which would characteristically present with neonatal acute liver failure with their characteristic features. So gestational alloimmune liver disease, they will have high ferritin, high alpha fetoprotein, profound coagulopathy. The diagnosis will be confirmed by lip biopsy and confirming the iron deposition in the salivary glands in the lip biopsy or MRI scan to look for extrahepatic iron deposition. The treatment would be exchange transfusion and immunoglobulins. Failing that, they would require liver transplantation, and they do well after liver transplantation. Galactosemia, they may present with E. coli sepsis, coagulopathy, and you know the characteristic test findings. If you suspect them, keep them nearby mouth initially, and you could start soy-based formula later on. If the liver recovers, then that's all right. You can continue with soy-based formula. Sometimes the liver doesn't recover due to the damage, so you might need liver transplantation in view of acute liver failure, not really due to galactosemia, because their liver damage is so severe they don't recover, so you would need to replace that liver. Tyrosinemia, again, they could present with the acute liver failure in neonate. Urine succinylacetone would be positive. In older child, you may use nitisinone, but younger child, if they come with acute liver failure, they may require liver transplantation. Sepsis, it's very important to consider treatment with acyclovir if you see a neonate with acute liver failure, because that is something which is treatable. E. coli sepsis, enterovirus sepsis, again could cause similar picture. Specific antivirals, antibiotics or IVIG infusions in severe sepsis would help. And failing that, again, they might need liver transplantation in the context of acute liver failure, irrespective of the etiology. Hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, pancytopenia, and you know it has got its own diagnostic criteria. It might need immunosuppression, chemotherapy, or stem cell transplant. And there are cases where children require liver transplantation for hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. Sometimes the liver transplantation was done first and subsequently stem cell transplant was done. Because when you go ahead with stem cell transplant, they would require a lot of medications which would cause liver toxicity. So the native liver which has got the damage initially would not sustain that liver damage. So they might need liver to be replaced with a new liver before they go ahead with stem cell transplant. So there were cases, patients who had liver transplant before their stem cell transplant. Mitochondrial hepatopathy would present with acute liver failure in newborn. They will have high lactate, you could do genetics. And if you think about mitochondrial hepatopathy, liver transplantation is contraindicated. So the other diseases, the list is quite long, but I'm not going to go through them. You could have a look at the slides and think about them if you do not find any other etiology in your evaluation, but these are very uncommon disorders. Finally, I'm reaching to the end of the presentation. I wanted to mention a word about neonatal hepatitis syndrome. This word is been used in different contexts in clinical setup. It's kind of an umbrella term and differently used by different individuals. One might call neonatal hepatitis syndrome for congenital infection, or it might be used for Alagille syndrome as well sometimes, because you might see hepatitis picture. So better try to define the cause of cholestasis with the specific etiology. And I think we should avoid using neonatal hepatitis syndrome as much as possible. Whenever possible, we should give the diagnosis or differential diagnosis. In cases where you don't have a diagnosis, it may be prudent to say cholestasis undiagnosed rather than neonatal hepatitis syndrome. Because in certain ultrasound scans also, we see radiologists comment about neonatal hepatitis syndrome, because you can't see neonatal hepatitis syndrome on ultrasound scan. So it's used in different contexts and the meaning has got lost on the way. So I think it's better to avoid that term in clinical context, which is confusing in communications. So use the diagnosis or differential diagnosis or cholestasis undiagnosed. Finally, the general management of any child with cholestasis, optimization of the nutrition, vitamins, also managing their pruritus and supportive care, counseling and follow-up are very important. And most of the cases, especially the multifactorial ones, septic related ones, or sometimes parenteral nutrition associated cholestasis, all these things would settle with nutritional stabilization as well as with ursodeoxycholic acid. Once you have excluded your priorities, you may bet, provided child's synthetic functions are not deteriorated. So you just need to start urso fat soluble vitamins and nutritional rehabilitation. And if it is persistent, you may expand your investigation. So coming to the end, few take-home messages. Any child with prolonged jaundice requires split bilirubin and examination for pale stools. Conjugated hyperbilirubinemia and pale stools, biliary atresia, underscrew and otherwise. Diagnosis of biliary atresia and neonatal acute liver failure are emergencies. All the other possibilities could wait. Nutrition is very important and it should not be overlooked. It is something, a medication which would facilitate hepatic recovery. Early shared care with a liver transplant center is crucial and it improves long-term outcomes.